Okay, we call the meeting of the Bennington School Board for November 2nd order. First item on the agenda is a presentation by Ms. Boudreau, Jim Law, Ms. Colley, and Dr. Munkins.
All right. Thank you for having us.
Thank you.
Thank you. Do you guys want one?
I can get yours.
Thank you, Ogo. Okay, great. Oh. Okay, so thanks for having us. And we're here to share with you the Bennington School District. Where are we now? Where are we going? We're going to reflect back on the goals.
I'll move over here because the camera's on.
Okay. We're going to reflect back on the goals from we set last year and give you some updates about where we're heading this year.
Oh.
So the first piece of information that you see comes from the Vermont Agency of Education, and it's the timeline as we shift from No Child Left Behind to Every Child Succeeds Act. And we shared this with you as well last year, but this is the last year before we're back into a new accountability system next year. And the state of Vermont is in the process right now of presenting their plan to the federal government, which will have the indicators that we'll be using in our accountability system. Every school is working towards building a multi-tiered systems of support, which is required by the Vermont Educational Quality Standards, which has a balanced tiered system between academics and behavior supports. This is our local visual that we use to describe our system. And at the bottom of our pyramid, that's represents good first instruction tier one for all students, and with a balance between academics, behavior, and this year we've added a tier one social emotional tool called Connect with Kids that's being used in all three of our BSD schools. Sometimes we have kids that need more support, which is tier two, and that's for some students and it's targeted. And then the goal is we collect some data and ultimately move them right back into tier one, and sometimes we have students, a few students, that need intense targeted instruction. The information on the left side is a reminder that we're working to be in compliance with Act 77, which is all about putting students at the center of their education. And on the right side, every school has an educational support team. That's the problem-solving team that helps us to support teachers and building staff when problems arrive, and it acts as a problem-solving pyramid. We want to remind you, and we started to share this information with you last year because we want to describe the shift in Vermont with the changes in assessments. 13-14 was the last year that we gave the NECAP in reading and math. 14-15 was the first year that the state asked us to give the Smarter Balanced Assessment Consortium. And that was just a year that every student tried it out. Last year, our students took the SBAC again, and the state of Vermont is finding that the Smarter Balanced Assessment Consortium is valid and reliable, so this is our baseline year. So starting next year, we'll be doing a comparison model, and this year our students will be taking SBAC in English Language Arts and Math in the spring. So again, the big updates, we're going to be sharing the Smarter Balanced Assessment Consortium data with you during the presentation, so I'll be jumping back in as each school presents. Again, we're just looking, we have been advised by the state, we're just looking at this baseline data this year, and next year we'll be doing a comparative model. And again, that starting this time next year, we'll be back in an accountability system with more indicators than just this one assessment. So I'm going to start to turn this over to our three schools in the Bennington School District, and they're going to share what's happening in their world.
Bennington Elementary, like the other schools, has a vision or expectations for students. And I'm not going to read word for word what this is, but basically, we want to make sure that the environment is safe, it's nurturing, and that students have academic opportunities that will help perfect their skills, improve their skills, and that they can be successful, so that they can be positive, productive members of the community. We focus on what we call PAWS, which is part of our PBIS format. PAWS is being prepared, acting kindly, working hard, and making safe choices. We feel that that will enable them to be successful academically, socially, emotionally, behaviorally, that it'll be a positive experience for everybody. Our reading and math goals for 2015-16 were to have a 2 to 5% increase according to MAP scores in grades 3 through 5, and MAP meaning measures of academic progress, which is the computer-based assessment program that all three elementary schools use. Our scores on the past testing were not what we expected and not where we really want to be. Our math growth was 3.7%, which is within the range that we had been looking for. Our reading scores were 2.1% increase, and that's at the very bottom edge, and that's not good enough for us. We do need to do better, need to make some changes in order to help kids be more successful.
So this is the Bennell Spring Math SBAC data, and Orion, just to describe the setup of this information. The state is in blue all the way on the left, and the district is red in the middle, and Bennell is all the way on the right side, and it lists the three grades. So this is math. And then the same setup for ELA, with the state all the way on the left, the district in the middle, and Bennell on the right. And again, this is our baseline data. So with this data,
we have established new goals for the new year. Again, the 2 to 5% is somewhat of a standard. That's, you know, the minimum bar we want to be looking at, which is a typical year growth for everyone. Given that our scores were what they were, we're looking at 24 to 27% of our students being proficient in math, 27 to 30 proficient in English language arts. That's a low number, but if we can achieve that, we'll be on track to being more successful. We can't expect ourselves to go from a low percentage to 90%. Incremental growth is more lasting and more effective long-term than a huge kind of swinging back and forth with numbers. We do admit that we need to be better, to do better, but that's our current goal. Our action steps in order to help achieve that success is we will be implementing the comprehensive integrated three-tiered preventive model that all three schools would be working on. We mentioned that at a couple of previous board meetings. That is a plan that is multi-tiered. It does address behavioral, academic, and social emotional components. Our students need all three of those, and we're putting that together in a package to help them be successful. We'll be doing professional development in Collins writing, which Monument and Pownall have already initiated. It's been shown that improvement in writing is a cross-content improvement if you can be successful. That Collins writing is presented by a fellow named Bill Atwood, who's been very successful with some math work in the district. Teachers love him. They actually implement what he does present because it's practical. We will be having action plans at grade level, not just the building. We've already developed some of those in our in-services that we had earlier this year. Each a grade-level team who will be developing, or has developed at this point, action plans, and that will be progress monitored over a 4 to 6 week period. A new benchmark will be established, whether they were successful or unsuccessful, and then a new plan developed to try to either improve from that new point or to change strategies to make sure that we are going in the right direction. We will be using data. It's not just a whimsical, let's try this, let's try that. The data will be reviewed, we'll be doing progress monitoring, and that will drive the decision making that we have at the building level. We also will be institutionalizing the revised educational support team procedures. That does require that there are a number of strategies that are tried in the classroom as a first level good instruction before we start referring students to special education. That means that it won't be a case of, oh, this didn't work, let's just throw a child into a special program. We'll try strategies. If they're successful, wonderful. If they're not, we'll try more strategies. Once a number of those don't seem to be getting any ground under us, then there would be a more in-depth review of what we might be able to try with the EST team to help the student be more successful.
So, good evening, and I'm pleased to represent the community of Monument. We continue to commit to the understanding and the vision that we are a unified learning community where everyone has a sense of belonging. Our expectations that we support and we model each and every day at Monument include being positive, safe, responsible, kind, and respectful. We have a leadership team who is reflective and a voice of our community, and we have a 3-year plan, but our goal for last year, by June 2016, we were expecting our students in grades 3 through 5 to meet a projected growth rate of 2 to 5%, which equates, it's not just picking out the 2 to 5%, that really equates to an individual learner's year's worth of growth. So we're pleased to report that we exceeded that goal. We have many instructional components that went into supporting students in order to exceed that goal. We're very, very pleased, but we're not done. So we need to continue to support students.
So this is Monument's SBAC data from this past spring. And just again, this is math. And on the left is the state, and the district is in the middle, and Monument is on the right. And the second slide is English Language Arts. And again, the state is on the left, and the district is in the middle, and Monument is on the right.
So what's important to remember is we're providing that data to you for a reason, and it's our job to reflect upon that data and put that data into action about where we're going next with children. So our goal, we actually have that 3-year goal. We started in 2015. That goal by June 2018, we're projecting that 90% of those current second graders will be proficient or higher in reading, math, and behavior as measured by FastBridge, measures of academic progress, our school-wide informational system, and our student risk screening scale. So it's really important to remember that we are projecting and we are creating goals reflective upon the data that we're gathering. By June 2017, again, we're looking at children to make 1 year's worth of growth, which equates to that 2 to 5%. And then of course, as the state says, and as Laura has said, we're moving to proficiency goals. So that really looks as though by 2017, we're projecting that 68 to 71% of our students in grades 3 through 5 will be proficient in math, and 61 to 64%
will be proficient in English language arts as measured by the SBAC assessment, Smarter Balanced Assessment Consortium. To get there, we have to do some things. So we're looking to secure equitable resources, including the professional and support personnel to ensure implementation of our comprehensive, integrated, three-tiered model of prevention, which includes progress monitoring for Tier 2 and Tier 3 services, those students who we know are not responding to our Tier 1 instruction. We're going to continue to have a data and school leadership team, which is a voice collectively for our entire staff and community to monitor 2015, our 2015 to 2018 school improvement plan. We are implementing currently individual action plans for our students who have been identified on our SRS, our student risk screener, for at-risk indicators of social and emotional development. And those action plans will be shared with parents during their upcoming teacher-parent conference. We're going to continue our professional collaboration, support for professional development from the SVSU, contracted and outside contracted experts. As Mr. Law had shared, Collins Writing is one example of that, and Bill Atwood, who comes and works with our team of teachers, and we're currently continuing that work with him. And we're also working in conjunction with Pownall Elementary School in regards to the instruction and student intervention in mathematics and English language arts. And then finally, a collaborative teaming to support our kindergarten transition events, including summer programming, proactive screening, assessments for effective identification of incoming kindergarten student needs. We're pleased with our collaboration with early education, and we're looking forward to continuing that this year. Thank you.
Welcome to Molly Stark. I'm glad I'm going last so I don't have to read all of those acronyms and everything that they stand for. So you already know them and have them memorized, I'm sure. Molly Stark's vision has one key word, all. And a vision is just words until you breathe life into it with actions and commitment. And the essence of what I'm going to be talking about this evening from Molly Stark's standpoint is the need for that all to come to life. That all of the service providers, all of the teachers in varied configurations and formats recognize that we have to collaborate and cooperate in order to serve the interests of our 401 learners. So it's nice to have that vision. It's our compelling responsibility to make that a reality. Our pillars that support Molly Stark are the expectation that everyone in the building recognize the need to be safe, to be kind, to be responsible, and to be respectful. Our 2015-16 reading and math goal here at Molly Stark indicated an interest in grades. The learners in grades 3 through 5 will meet projected growth rates. As Donna and Jim have pointed out, that 2 to 5% represents a year's growth. And while that's our goal, we need to be higher than that to close the gap. And you'll see in the next slide that 2 to 5% in math, the average growth in those grades for our learners was 5.3%. And that's a compliment to the people who've provided services in math. Yet, it's something that we have, as you'll see in the data later on in this presentation, that we're going to have to increase our performance levels if we're expecting to catch up and reach our potential. In reading, 4.2% average growth.
And Ben, this is Molly Stark's math SBAC data from the spring with the state on the left, the district in the middle, and Molly Stark on the right. And this is Molly Molly Stark's SBAC data for English Language Arts, again with the state on the left and the district in the middle, and Molly Stark on the right.
We will extend our goal, as it has been last year, of projected growth rates of 2 to 5% in reading and math as measured by the measures of academic progress, the MAP tests. And again, that equates to 1 year of progress. We're also looking in the lower grades, kindergarten, first, and second, to reduce the number of learners who have been identified as at risk. The FastBridge assessment that we use will indicate whether a learner is a high risk, some risk, or low risk, or not at all. Our goal is to have learners who are high risk move down, and each level be reduced by 10%, so that we're decreasing the at-risk learner population here. By June of 2017, this would be a floor as opposed to a ceiling, and that would be 27 to 30% of our learners in grades 3 through 5 to be proficient in math, 40 to 45% in ELA. And that's based on the state assessment of Smarter Balance Assessment Consortium. In order to pursue that goal, we have a need to form an organizational culture that focuses on teaching and learning. Part and parcel of that, and again, it goes back to all of us working together, being collaborative, pooling our resources. We have the capacity within this building to achieve the goals that we have. It's a matter of providing the proper conditions and the support, and my responsibility to provide the leadership for that. One example is a shared decision-making team that we are creating here that will represent constituent stakeholder groups, support staff, a variety of different teaching groups, parents, and myself. The two primary focal points for that group is to review our schedule as if it hasn't existed. We are alone in that we have a 6-day schedule as opposed to a Monday through Friday. It's confusing to me. I'm sure it's got to be for a kindergartner to determine whether today is day 2, day 3, or day 4. It may be that after a year of exhausting all alternatives and looking at the schedule like it's a Rubik's Cube, that perhaps this is the best that it can be. But we need to be assured that we have uncovered every stone and looked at optimizing the schedule here to the benefit of our learners. The same can be said of our space use. We have 52,000 square feet of space here. It is adequate to meet our needs. However, the way it's organized, much of which we have little control over, begs some of the concerns. So we have 5 different classrooms that can only be accessed by going through the library. So we have the space, it's just designed in a very unusual manner. And that gets back to working together and collaborating and cooperating. If you're familiar with the layout of the building, it's like 2 or 3 different cul-de-sacs. It's not a building where it promotes trafficking among people, where I could stop and see another teacher and say, hey, I'm working on this issue, and how are you doing it in your classroom? Because we have a kindergarten wing that is, as I said, like a cul-de-sac. It goes off, you only go there for the express purpose of going to kindergarten. And similarly, we have a wing that ends, and so you only go there if you're taking your kids to art. So there's not a lot of that interaction, and we have to contrive opportunities to bring people together, and the teachers are doing this in their collaborative team efforts, and they meet in that role once a week. They have a universal template and grade level goals. We want to, as Bennington Elementary and Monument have pointed out, access available resources both within the district and outside of the district to partner with organizations that share common goals with us. I'm pleased that the district has embraced the CI3T because it acknowledges that while we are measured, if you will, by our SBAC scores, that the scores that we have are contingent in large part on the behavioral and social domains. So this recognizes that while public schools are often evaluated on the basis of their assessments and academics, that the district recognizes behavioral and social elements are very, very important. At Molly Stark, we'd like to identify baseline data to benchmark future improvements. For example, this year we had 208 parents attend our open house. However, that's meaningless because we don't know how many attended last year. And what we're looking for are those reference points that will allow us to identify small incremental victories. So it would be nice to say this year we had 208, last year there was 150. That's a sign of increased parent engagement. Parent engagement is part of that concept that I talked about, all, the unifying community that Donna spoke of in Monument. So parent engagement is one. Staff turnover is another one. It's a critical concern, not just here at Molly Stark. Filling vacancies costs time, which is money, whether it's the search and selection process, advertising, any number of hidden costs are associated with hiring someone. If we train them, whether it's in Go Math or CI3T or foundations, the programs that we are sponsoring here in the district, and then they leave us, we have lost the investment of that training. Furthermore, regardless of who replaces them, there's that transition period for them to get up to speed, to become familiar with the curriculum, become familiar with the context of the school and the direction. So one of my major responsibilities this year is to provide the environment, leadership, and the conditions that encourage people to stay. We have our neediest learners who are receiving services in special education and in intervention programs in math and ELA. We have nearly 12 people in those two areas, only one of whom has been in their current role for more than 5 years. Now, that doesn't discount the contributions of the people in that role, but what it does mean is our neediest learners may be taught by our least experienced teachers. And so we have to stem that bleeding and provide a reason for people to stay and convince them of their investment and commitment in the district. That can be measured in the number of applicants, the number of transfer requests, and looking at staff turnover. Attendance is similar. Referrals not only for the office in terms of discipline, but in positive ticket acquisitions. So staff members, from bus drivers through food service and everyone in between, have the ability to recognize when children are demonstrating desired behaviors that contribute to a positive learning environment. So we need to measure those tokens of praise and positive reinforcement. Again, looking at social and behavioral and how they contribute to our academic goals. Finally, the reality is, without putting a bullseye in the back of every staff member here at Molly Stark, the reality is we represent 50% of the learner population in Bennington School District. Just the numbers indicate that if we're underperforming, then the district's going to be underperforming. The sheer weight of 50% of the learner population means that for the district to elevate their overall performance, the average is, we can be an anchor to that average. So it's up to Molly Stark to recognize that the weight of those numbers and elevate our performance metrics for the benefit of the entire district. And finally, as I intimated earlier, that while we are data-driven, and we are committed to turning data into informed decision making and bringing that data to life, it's important that beyond the SBAC scores, beyond all these assessments we talked about that measure academic progress or lack thereof, is we can't let the facts and the figures of that data obscure the faces and feelings of those learners behind the data. And in closing, a quote attributed to several different people, let's remember that not everything that can be counted counts. And not everything that counts can be counted. And it's important, I think, as a board, to recognize that whole child and the need to invest and address the needs socially and behaviorally in order to increase our academic performance. Thank you.
The resources that we would need in order to support the goals that we've established, we would need to secure equitable resources across the BSD schools. That doesn't mean equal resources necessarily, but it means equitable for the needs in each individual building to try to support the learners that we're trying to support. And we would be looking for support in our implementation of the CI3T plans. We would ask you to be mindful of what those plans are for each of us, and offer for you to be thinking about operating in a way that models or shows the same thing that we're trying to model and show with our students. That social, emotional, behavioral competencies are all important for students. We don't ignore the academic. That's one of our prime purposes. But we also need to be looking at who the kids are, how we can support them in getting into a better place than they may be at the moment. And we would encourage the board to explore opportunities or support our exploration of opportunities to deal in partnerships with members of the community or organizations in the community, such as UCS, hospital, any other organizations that would be likely to support families and children in improving the lot of the community as a whole. Thank you.
Thank you.
So we want to thank you very much. And does anyone have any questions?
I have a couple questions. How much collaboration is done between the three of you and your teachers?
I'm not sure anyone, but I can tell you that we have already worked together about our teachers working with other teachers in the elementary schools. I'll give you one short example. We had interventionists from our school go and meet with other interventionists at another school so that they could share their protocol, what they're doing for students, what things were working, and specifically around how we are managing and scheduling and supporting students on Tier 2, 3. So we do collaborate together, not only just in the BSD, but also within the SVSU. Because Pownall Elementary School and Monument Elementary School we're kind of at different places with our Collins writing. So right now they're moving forward as professionals, and they're actually mapping our writing process in our K-1 grades, which we are then sharing with other elementary schools within the SVSU, Bennington Elementary, Monument, and Shasbury. So we're doing the work as collaborators, and we're sharing that work. And I'm not sure.
Yep. There are also district meetings with grade levels, with content areas, mm-hmm. with interventionists, with special education.
Do you want me to jump in? Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I provided a resource with you a couple meetings ago where I listed all the curriculum teams and the members from the BSD. So I'm proud to say that every school has, for the most part, representation and sometimes in a large number on each one of these teams. And they're coming together for various things throughout the school year and then working in the summer. And it's by far the highlight of my job to bring them together, mm-hmm. because the power that the teachers and the interventionists and the special education staff bring to the table and share benefits each one of these buildings. So, and I can bring that back to the surface again.
How often do they meet?
It depends on the group. Mm-hmm. So there's curriculum groups for every for every year. So for we're providing ongoing math learning this year. So every 6 weeks this year, second and fourth grade teachers come for a half a day to get tier one instruction. And there's representation from these buildings working together with Pat Conway, the math coach, mm-hmm. And myself. That's one example. ELA has met, had two formal meetings, and then helped to facilitate the district in-service day this past Friday, where we were in grade level teams, mm-hmm. And they were all together collaborating.
There are also some less formalized opportunities. For example, if Ben L is looking at a particular program or materials, and we know or have heard that one of the other buildings has tried it, mm-hmm. Those grade level people making mm-hmm. connection and how did it work? What were the benefits? What were the problems?
A year ago, we gave you, we cut teaching time by a half an hour so that mm-hmm. Teachers would have time to collaborate. Are we still doing that? Mm-hmm. Are we still?
Regularly.
We have regular, regular schedule.
We have a problem here at this school. I wasn't sure.
Now that's a good question, because we have a universal template, and I was referencing that in the presentation, that it's not just a grade level, but as we think of it, for instance, third grade teachers, but service providers in third grade, special ed, interventionist, a counselor, depending on the issue, and they have a protocol with universal norms, and within 2 days of their meetings, provide a copy to me so that I can look at them across the grades, so that we don't have grades going in all different directions, but to keep a focal point on teaching and learning. So that's something that they do on a weekly basis. And I've been very impressed with the collaboration meetings I've attended in terms of their focus and commitment. And I would say this, I've worked in a number of different districts. If there were any more of those collaborative efforts at the district level, I would say it's too much. And I'm glad to be able to say that. You reach a balance where the teacher recognizes the need to learn a new skill or gain experience, whether it's a technology or a new curriculum, and at the same time, in the back of their mind, they're thinking, what's going on in the class while I'm out? We're currently, at least I can say at Molly Stark, stretched to get substitute teachers. And so if we had any more professional development outside the building, I'd say it's too much. So there's a lot of collaboration on a formal level in terms of like the full day PD that we recently had at the middle school. At the informal level, in collaboration meetings, and then as Donna pointed out, when a contingent of interventionists came from Monument here to share their perspective, how they organize and deliver instruction. So I've been very impressed as someone from the outside to see that level of collaboration.
My concern is that, we have probably excellent teachers that teach, I know we have excellent teachers that teach a certain way in one school, mm-hmm. and there may be a teacher, say, at your school that's mm-hmm. struggling, mm-hmm. and somehow I would like to make sure that your teacher is getting hooked up with the one that is having the greatest results.
We have required mentors, and again, that's when I talked about staff turnover, that's one of those hidden costs. Every new staff member has a mentor, and while it's not a break the bank fee that we're compensating those mentors, it's time that they're spending on that after school that they could be doing other things. So there are hidden costs in time and effort and training, and providing mentors is one of them.
I got one more question on these. Why are the children in fifth grade, as I look at these, why are their scores always lower than third grade, fourth grade?
So again, the SBAC is really new, and so we're not doing a lot of interpretation. But one thing we have noticed, especially when we, I think last week was SBSU, when we looked at the whole piece, one thing we noticed was with the math, there was a state line doing that, and then our data, which was interesting, we were following the state trend. And so we're kind of following the lead of the state right now as they investigate the data as well, but that observation you made is the same observation. So next year is that third year when things are supposed to be valid and reliable, and so we're going to continue to look at that. I mean, it's hard because we've shipped assessments, so we only have 2 years of and this past year is the only year we're really looking at. This is our baseline. So we're going to be watching that over time to see what happens. But yeah, we did.
And if I could add that there's a great amount of research from neuroscientists that regardless of the assessment, regardless of the state, if you look at every state's accountability system, that the middle grades, 5th, 6th, 7th, tend to plateau. And again, a lot of that is from neuroscientists who will look at brain development. And it doesn't matter if you call it SBAC or whatever acronym you have, the trend nationally is that there's a plateau 5th, 6th, and 7th grade. Yes.
I have a question. Why is the expectation of Ben Ellen and Molly so low? And Ben L, it's 24% to 27%, and in Molly, it's 27% to 30%. Mm-hmm. Why is that expectation of improvement so low?
It's we're starting low. That is, they're low. They're proportionate to the starting point at both schools. I mean, we could flatter you and put 80%, and that's what we would like. That doesn't mean we have low expectations. If you look at the scores at Molly Stark, in particular in math in fifth grade, they're low. And we're looking at that incremental growth to ask the teachers and learners to say, okay, we're going to go from 24% to 60%. We all want that and more for our own kids. But realistically, we're going to look at what's a smart goal. What can we expect to go from 12% or 20%? And we're expecting more than that. But that would be a realistic goal at this point. It's certainly not what we want, but nor do we want to have a goal of 80% and have the kids go from 24% to 50%. And they still have failed because they haven't reached that 80%.
I'd rather see it at 50% myself, but the test scores that are reported, are they a year behind or the present year?
This was, they're from the SBAC that was taken in the spring. This right. past spring.
So the fifth graders here are really sixth graders and the fourth graders?
Yes.
Correct.
Right.
Yes, that's correct, yes.
Mm-hmm. So what we want to see then are the same grade level, but are they the same kids?
They will be a different
kids.
Yes. Eventually,
they will be this. They will be fourth and fifth. The current last year's fourth and fifth graders. I mean, excuse me. Last year's third and fourth graders will be a part of that because they will be the fourth and fifth graders this year, and then a new grade level, third grade this year, will be new students. So you have some students
so
that
we
will
only
be
have year to year, but not class to class.
No.
And one of the challenges is the fact that we don't get those scores until after.
Sorry,
One of the challenges we face is that we don't get the results until after the school year starts. So it's confusing that the SBAC scores that we just mailed out, they're from last spring. And it's not because we've been sitting on them. We just haven't gotten them from the state. And ideally, you want an assessment that will generate results before the end of the school year, so it will help Laura and others at the central office to plan summer professional development. It will help the teachers who are getting those kids. So if I'm teaching fifth grade, I will get this year's fourth grade scores and incorporate that into my planning. But I won't get their scores, at least this year, until after school starts. So it is problematic in that the state has delayed that.
Well, it's problematic for me that we're not seeing the same kids tested. So when you see a mm-hmm. test score like this, you're talking about a whole new group of people.
Right.
So mm-hmm. you can't project 20%, 50% growth on a whole new group that you mm-hmm. don't even know where they're starting from.
Right.
Well, two-thirds, generally speaking, two-thirds of the group would be the same, in that the third and the fourth grade would still be consistent, having the fifth grade drop off and the second grade coming in to the third.
So not when they're reported like this. They're not reported. This doesn't say last year's fourth grade. It says this year, it says fourth grade.
Right.
So I guess what I'm asking for is, can we take these scores and project a growth to the next year on the same kids instead of different kids?
Go ahead. I'm sorry. I just wanted to add one thing too. Remember, this is just one data point. SBAC is just one data point. But really, it's the underlying that when you think about what assessments are used for, that's a piece of data. And we're really looking at taking a group of data. And really, the underlying projection is, what are we doing instructionally for children? And so that's the value of, yes, this is the data. So now let's go back and look, and let's look at the data and look at it deeper. And what are we doing as instructors in the classroom? And what could we maybe do differently? That's the action. So I,
so
you know.
So it's really for instructional purposes, and it's not.
All data is.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All data is.
The problem is, these things get published.
Mm-hmm. And I get it.
This is not.
Yeah, it's the state.
And then we have people out there saying, we can't get anybody in town because of this. You have such terrible schools in Bennington. And that's the president of the hospital.
And that's clearly inaccurate, because we have great schools
that.
In Bennington. And we have excellent educators.
I know.
And
that.
We have excellent collaborators. And we have wonderful community members. And we have excellent children in our schools. And that's a perception that sometimes is based on one data point.
That's why, if we could get what Jackie's asking for, the growth of a student, if we could follow
our map
class,
data shows that. Our map data does show that.
It would be helpful.
Yeah. Right.
But
and
this
that
is, also,
is a state assessment.
Right.
But this is also, I'm going back to the resources needed. This is also a reflection somewhat of a bigger need in the community, not just the schools.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, we bear a portion of that burden. There is no question.
A huge portion.
But there are other needs that are affecting children in the community that are beyond what we can currently provide. And that's why partnerships and supports as an expanding social community to support kids is necessary.
But you're predicting less achievement in your math scores in your school, because this year in grade 3 students were, let's say, 32%, and you're saying 24 to 27%.
Yeah.
In grade 4, or is that a whole average?
It's an average.
That's
so
an average.
That's
yeah.
an average for that grade span of 3, because the SBAC is only given in grades 3 through 5, so it's an average of that grade great span. And I want to go back to what Donna had suggested. This is one measure, and we have to remember that we've been in this 2-year waiver period with the state of Vermont. So what we're going to be back in an accountability system next year, and the plan that the state is submitting to the federal government right now has other indicators that we'll be presenting to you next year. So there's going to be a bigger picture. So we're still in the end of this waiver period, and we're waiting. But again, next year we might be looking at attendance alongside SBAC data and alongside science data, and there are other indicators that we're waiting to hear from. So we're still in that really funky year, but ultimately we hope to have other pieces of data to share alongside this next year.
All the legislation that happened because of No Child Left Behind was to say that if children aren't reading, writing, and doing math by grade three, you can forget about it. And they aren't. And then if they do it, then they slip down.
So ultimately, I'm feeling really good in the last 2 years about the teams of teachers and professional staff that are working towards us meeting action steps in buildings based on the data that they're looking at. And we're looking forward to starting to see gains, but we're also looking forward to being able to report out on many other indicators when we look at a child, a whole child, than just one test that was given. It's one snapshot.
Okay.
It's one.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, we know we have great needs. And all this of the community in Bennington has been having all these little, I guess they're large gatherings of talking about education, jobs, poverty. Maybe our schools should have a summit and explain to the area just exactly what we deal with in our schools and what we need.
Can I just share? I think that we all agree that that's where we need to go. And I know that.
Oh, yeah, I know.
And I know that that is where we, and we have had those conversations. I know that these gentlemen right now are in conversation with United Counseling Service about having support of the mental health needs that we need in our school. I actually attended a juvenile justice meeting, which I have attended more than one. And I brought our CI3T plan, and I've shared with our community partners, this is about engagement, and it is about our community, and it's just not about our school. So here's our plan, and we have tier one supports, and we have tier two supports, and I had every single one of those individuals from those organizations, including our judge, our state attorney, United Counseling Service, our Sheriff's Department, all sat at that table. Turn to the last page, that's tier three. I can't do this alone. These gentlemen can't do this alone. We can't do this alone. We need to be a community. And I actually said to them, I'm gonna be knocking on your door. I'm gonna be calling. We want to work, all three of us, including Shasberry and Pownall. This is about an entire district that needs to start thinking about how we work together. And it's not just your job or my job, it's our job. So we are reaching out, we are doing that, and I completely agree that it would be lovely and really inspiring for those community members to walk into our door and cross our threshold and say, how can we help?
Well, somehow we have to put that at forefront. And we're going into budget season, and you're going to be talking about equitable support, so I guess we're going to expect exactly what you want. You're going to need to be able to present it with data and how it's going to help you. That's my feelings anyways.
Okay. Well, thank you very much, everybody. You put a lot of work into that. Okay, next item is citizens' comments. Do we have any citizens? Okay, seeing none, the task list, previous meeting.
All right, dental forms, home, email. I don't know if that, my email was.
No, no, that was Jim saying dental forms to go out in email.
Check with lawyer, HIPAA, can it be done electronically to get permission for students to get dental stuff in school? And Jim, you were supposed to do that. Projections of enrollment for class sizes. We will need this to make decisions when budgeting or deciding to redistrict. That was supposed to be Renee. Communicate to principal about Nature's Classroom. Find teachers from Molly and Ben L who are willing to go on trip. And that was supposed to be Jim, but I reached out to both Jim Law and Jim. Mm.
Mike.
Dr. Mudgets, I'm sorry, Mike, about this. And were you able to find any teachers? Yeah.
I extended the offer, and they're considering it, but there's been no commitment yet.
I met with the representatives of the parent-teacher group with the idea of Nature's Classroom. And that was something that they had mixed feelings about in terms of the destination, the time, and the commitment. And so at that point, you know, we just decided to review it. They had several questions about the program.
When's the next parent and teacher's class?
Would be the...
Next Thursday.
I'm sorry?
Next Thursday.
Yeah. And so some of the questions, and our PTG president is here, but some of the questions would be, well, does everyone have to go? What if we don't want to go? What if we didn't want to go for that duration of time? The amount that we would have to raise exceeds the entire budget raised by the PTG last year by $2,000. And so it was, there was a sense that maybe we would want a different opportunity, some other place. And so it was just, it was raised because of the discussion at the last board meeting, and that's where we've been.
Okay. What's the date on your next meeting?
17.
17. Yeah.
Could I also clarify for the board that our parent group at Monument is not the fundraising venue for Nature's Classroom? No funds whatsoever from our parent group AIM commits to the fundraising efforts for Nature's Classroom. That is completely AIM, the AIM group, Adults Interested in Monument. That's a group that really is a voice for K through 5. Mm-hmm. So there was a clear commitment that if a grade level was interested in such a trip, that it was going to be spearheaded by the parents in that grade level for funds. So AIM does not contribute whatsoever to the funds needed for the fifth grade trip.
That was one of the concerns.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And in our discussions with the principals, my discussion with the principals is also, that's the model that Shaftesbury uses. It's not their parent-teacher group that raises the money for Nature's Classroom. It is that specific grade parents
right.
that raise the money for that.
What is the cost per child?
So our understanding is Molly Stark would have to raise an additional $12,000 to match what the board says they're going to match. And for Bennington, $8,000 would be the cost that those parent groups would have to raise for everyone in those two grades to go. And that's...
So,
that's pretty steep.
No, we knew this one started it, and we decided as a group last year, as a board, could you arrange a meeting with your fifth grade parents?
Are you talking to me? I'm sorry. I thought you were pointing to him.
Certainly could extend an invitation for fifth grade parents to attend a meeting to address that. Quite frankly, if the PTG, which represents the whole school and provides a lot of fundraising, and I believe $10,000 was what the entire budget was last year,
yeah.
we would be expecting the fifth grade to raise $12,000 beyond what the parent-teacher group has raised.
We're actually not expecting you guys to raise that much. We're expecting to raise part of this money
mm-hmm.
by going out to the community and asking for donations. That's how that one of the playgrounds got built here.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't the PTG, and I was on the PTG at the time many years ago. But we raised the money not through fundraisers that you usually do at school, but through donations. We hit up everybody. And we actually raised, and this was... My kids were going to school here, so it was many moons ago. $25,000 that year to put in a playground. Mrs. Pavlocki and I did work on that.
So one of the discussions we have with the principal is for this to be successful, it can't just be a top-down initiative.
Mm-hmm.
So it is critical that the parents of those grade right. levels are interested in
that. I agree. Our concern was equitable. That if one thing is offered to one school, if all the other surrounding schools are going, only two schools weren't going. And so we wanted to provide some equity.
And I understand.
We just spent 2 days learning about excellence through equity at a conference for Vermont school boards and superintendents. So, and how important it is, especially in our, you know, in districts, that we try to be equitable as possible in the SDSU and in the Bennington School District. So what we're trying to do is offer your students, who probably more than any students might need the chance of a lifetime, because it might, you know, my grandchildren went on this trip when I lived in Woodford, and you couldn't believe the things they come back and tell you. And they'll tell you what a wonderful trip this was and how much they learned that 1 week and the experiences they had. And I've heard this from many, many different kids that have went on this trip, and that's why I feel it's important. Because it's such a learning experience. It's packed full of learning experiences.
So as a teacher who was a nature classroom participant in my teaching years and spent a week out in the woods with my students, I think it is a very valuable program. But it's not the only one, and it's got to be the right fit. And we can be equitable without everybody being the same. So each school can have, and one thing that we have heard from our community sometimes is, why is every school doing the same thing, that you might as well just be one big school? So you could, there might be an other option for Molly Stark and Bennington Elementary School that is equitable but not the same. So I do agree that one thing that we should do is then organize a parent meeting to discuss what some of those options might be that fits their school. You know, I go back to what I've been hearing in the community, even with the Act 46 things, we have all these, six elementary schools within the SU, and everyone's running the same combination. Why aren't we looking at the possibility of some of these schools being a magnet school that focuses on certain areas? So again, I go back to, we can be equitable without everyone being the same. And that's from my meetings with the principals. That's besides all the concerns about money. That's one of the other themes that has come through. So, but we will, I'm hearing from our principals, we can get a fifth grade parent meeting together, organized, and get the conversation rolling with them. Because it's not fair to expect that the PTG would do that, and it's not the model that's working somewhere. And it would be great if the community wanted to contribute to it.
And can I just clarify, because I'm not sure if I heard that correctly, Jackie. I know that the board, and very graciously, has provided 50% if, per se, all fifth graders, that was your goal. You were hoping to provide that option and that experience for all fifth graders. And it was 50%. Did I hear you correctly and say you're not asking the schools now or the parents to raise the other 50%, or you're asking
not to raise all of it?
Not to raise.
We don't expect. I forgot. I have it all figured out at home. I didn't bring it with me. I'm sorry, but I figured out what each school would have to raise according to the number of students that you reported last month in your schools in your grade five. Okay. Per person, with the buses, the whole nine yards. I figured it all out. Your school was the least amount because you got the least amount of numbers of kids. Yours is the largest and yours is the next. What we were going to do is, Jackie and I, we were going to try to raise the money throughout the community. Your schools would be responsible to raise the rest of the money that we didn't raise. So we were figuring maybe we could raise half of that, and then you would only have to raise maybe $2,000 at your school.
But if the other two schools wanted to do something else, they would get the same amount of
sure.
relief, mm-hmm. and maybe not have to even raise any of it, because you know what we were given by the board would be adequate. For instance, you know, they might want to import some college students and have the college students teach them coding, or, you know, something else besides nature. But the fair isn't always equal, and
absolutely.
And so that's why we'd like to meet with the parents and ask them what they want to do, but explain what it is that nature's.
So that would be helpful to clarify, and I would say in this respect, our parents at Monument had projected that they needed to raise $12,000 to send their fifth grade students. Mm-hmm. The board has committed to 50% of that.
Yes.
That's $6,000. What I'm hearing this evening is you've done some calculations which may not even require them to raise the $6,000. Mm-hmm. So I would ask, maybe you could put it on the task list, because this is a very proactive. This is. She's talking to you. Sorry.
I'm sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry.
To you.
She wants to write something on task list.
All right.
Well, I'm saying that it might be helpful because we have a very proactive parent group who has already raised a significant amount of money because their goal was $12,000. They really need to know if they need to stop, which with what you are projecting and articulating here this evening, that would be important to know ASAP to stop, because I don't think we should be continuing our fundraising efforts if they have already raised that amount and you are gracious enough to support a certain calculation which has not been shared with us. So I would encourage you to share that calculation, because I think this community would also be pleased to not hear from us anymore about fundraising. Or competing fundraising. So I think that's really important, but I don't know what calculations that you've come up with, and that would be helpful.
Jim, can you get that information over to them?
No, I'll call her tomorrow.
I don't know what your fundraising plan is.
I got the price of what it is per student from Sandy Foster. She told me what the bus cost was. I added it all, you know, times your number of students.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So
you're only paying for half a bus because you go with Woodford. That's
we split the bus with Woodford.
Yes. Mm-hmm. You're only paying for half the bus because mm-hmm. you split it with Woodford. Mm-hmm. So I figured out what the cost of my money would be. That's what it costs every year to go. I did the same thing for Molly. I did the same thing for Benno.
Right.
Because there's no other cost.
Right.
So what cost per student.
So I think really what should happen, though, is that should go to the principals. That the principals should be calculating what the cost is for their building and projecting what it's going to be.
Oh, yeah, I know that.
Because that's. Yeah. That's what you're doing.
We already have our projected costs.
And then, and again, is that where that school is going to go?
Mm-hmm. And I did share the cost per student and what it would cost for a bus with both principals.
When I met with the principals, they gave me those mm-hmm. prices, and that's mm-hmm. the numbers that I stated this evening. But I think there's a lot of groundwork that needs to be done first.
Right.
Could I make a suggestion that we get all the necessary people together, but that we ought to also involve our business director to head this thing up and get the ball moving instead of our leaving tonight not knowing where we are? So I would say for the two Jackies.
I will meet with the principals again, and we will mm-hmm. we'll develop a plan of what needs to happen with each school, and then I'll be in contact with those board members. We'll involve Renee in this to confirm how much money actually is in the budget. Because I have to say I'm a little concerned about the board's commitment to 50%. Are we talking about this fiscal year? And is because if we're just learning what the price of what this was recently.
We did a ballpark figure of what it would cost for the number of students at one of our last budget sessions.
Right.
Because we were asked to keep the budget under a certain amount. Jackie and I fought until we got 50%, another 25%. $25,000 put in the budget specifically earmarked for Nature's Classroom, mm-hmm. so that only the other half of it would have to be raised. And honestly, when I did my figures, it comes out to just about 50,000.
So let's confirm that the 25,000 a line item in the budget.
Okay, Jim, you bet that up.
Yep. Yes.
All right.
We need 50 for all.
Okay, good.
All right. Okay, moving on. Finance, treasury report will be posted. Hasn't been posted yet.
Too early in the
morning. I haven't finished.
Oh, okay.
Principals need to break down truancy from absenteeism.
That is in progress.
Okay. Clarify Congress Street, why aren't they represented on absenteeism list? That was you, Jim. I called Marie and Ann and found out that Marie wanted to be a representative on the Act 46 advisory committee. I actually couldn't get a hold of Ann because I can't find her phone number anywhere. And we would like a correct class size numbers are with NEC and Acorns and Conquer Street taking out because they spend most of their days in NEC, Acorns, and Conquer Street. And I got Renee right for that.
So one thing that we're going to have to work out is the mechanism of this task list, because you're writing the task list and then I didn't get it.
I sent it to what's your name? Mary Lee. Next day, I emailed it to her.
Because I don't have it, so. So we'll have to work on the mechanics of that. Like if you're give it to me at the end of the night.
Yeah. Were you at the last meeting?
Is that, yeah. So what?
Oh, you weren't.
So
you
what was
going to the office?
So what was happening when Genevieve did the task list? Is she would hand me the task list at the end of the night, and then we would make a photocopy of it in the office the next morning, and then send it back to her.
And that's what I was going to do at the last meeting, but you were going to a meeting for 2 days and weren't going back, so you asked me to email it to Mary Lee.
You were
going
to try
and
give it to me,
and
I was going to be out, so you kept it.
Yes. Okay. And I emailed it to Mary Lee the next morning. I scanned it in and emailed it.
Cool.
Okay, at the end of the meeting.
Yep.
Yeah, thank you.
But okay. I will give it to you tonight.
Thank you.
Okay, consent agenda. Motion for a consent agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Any questions on the warrants?
No. But I have a question about the field trip request.
Okay.
Because if you're going to use the 50%.
Pardon?
If you're going to use the 50%, then you need to redo this because it's not all fundraising.
The Nature's Classroom. So what you were saying, because it has no budget code on it?
Mm-hmm.
We don't have a budget code.
You will have if you're using the money that we're going to give you.
So you would like the budget code of the 50% on there?
Mm-hmm. Please. That's all. That's why you're
Can we approve that? Can we approve that tonight with the acknowledgement that the finance office will add the budget code to that?
I'll make a motion. We approve it.
You already have a motion.
It's fine. Just a minute.
Okay. Any other questions? Seeing none, all in favor of the consent agenda? Okay. Policies, we have one, 1020 visit to schools, a motion to adopt this policy.
So moved.
Okay, and a second?
Second.
Three. All right. Any questions? Seeing none, all in favor of adopting policy 1020? Okay, unanimous. Superintendent's report.
Couple of comments more on the task list. We did talk about Nature's Classroom. The other thing that was asked of me was to review with the SVSU attorney the option of an opt-out clause on the dental, which easily explained is, rather than parents sending back a permission slip, we send out a form saying that, do you, if we don't hear from you, we're going to assume that that implies permission. So the attorney advised me that that is allowable, though the board should discuss whether they would recommend it, because
it's just
it is a medical procedure.
It's just a look at, isn't it?
It is.
It's just a visual check.
Some would view it as a medical procedure, and you don't have explicit permission for it. But the attorney did not see a major issue with it. Just if you wanted to be very cautious, the advice would be to have a permission slip on file as opposed to an opt-out, because you would have no proof that someone actually received the opt-out notification.
Mm-hmm. How do we get it on file?
Well, with a permission slip, if it returns it, if the parent returns the permission slip, then the school has that on file. But with an opt-out notification, we would have no documentation that the parent actually received it. You would have to have an acknowledgement form that they received the opt-out form, which is essentially the same thing. That was the caution with the opt-out.
Right,
you could do it, but...
Can we start, and this is what Jim, Carol, and I talked about, can we start with the opt-out, but eventually, as each child registered, that another thing would be in their packet as a permanent. Mm-hmm.
The caution again with the opt-out is that the school, the principals could be hearing from parents who said, "I had no idea that you were doing this with my child."
It was my understanding that if it didn't come back with a permission slip, that they wouldn't be looked at.
Right.
Right. But what Mr. Carroll asked last month and Jackie was the opt-out option rather than a permission slip.
Right.
And the attorney said, you can do that. And it's done elsewhere. You just run that risk that you may have a complaint that a procedure was done on their child, even though it was a two-minute, you know, observation and nothing done. You would just expose yourself to that.
Yeah, Jim wanted it to happen today. But I would prefer it happen in a packet where once a child registers for school, that they give permission for that to happen.
If they don't sign the form.
Or not give permission.
Or not give permission.
Right.
How often are people registered for school? I mean, is it just happen in kindergarten or preschool or?
Continual, isn't it?
Yeah, it's continuous for people coming in, but you know, traditionally the bulk of our students are registered for us as, you know, as kindergartners. But I mean, could going forward in the future, the packet that every student gets at the beginning of school sent home with them, that there's a form that goes to parents? Absolutely. We could do that. But it's the same thing. If it's a permission slip and they don't send it back, you don't have permission to do it.
Correct.
If it's just a notification that you're going to do this, you're going to do oral screenings, and it's a notification, and you do it, and somebody complains, you have no evidence that you warned them that you were going to do it, because you don't know if that packet got delivered.
No, I'd like the permission slip.
Okay, but that's not what Mr. Carroll was asking for.
I know,
right? Yeah.
I know.
All right.
But, you know, he also didn't check with any lawyers either.
Yeah.
And also at the dental commission, what was brought up is that in middle school and high school, it was we're going to do it. Mm-hmm. You know, please let us know if you don't want us to do it.
Well, I think we should go ahead and get it started.
The opt out.
Yes.
Yeah.
Permission.
Yeah.
Have oral screening dental forms been sent home?
You actually probably couldn't do that at Monument because we don't have the facility to do
right.
it.
You don't.
So you would be providing that for Molly Stark and Ben L.
It's on an upward bump.
You beat me to it. Okay.
I will say at Molly Stark, the first week of school, that little girl came up to me and said, "Dr. Mugits, could you look at my tooth?" And I think she knew that Dr. Brady was a dentist and thought that Dr. Mugits was also a dentist. So
you need to change
your we're expanding our screening.
How did that go?
I was like, I think you want to go down the hall there and see Dr. Brady.
So what does Bennington Oral Health Coalition want to do next?
It's not the coalition, it's the commission, town commission. They want to get it started. And so wherever it starts, it begins. If we continue to talk about it, it doesn't get started.
That's exactly why I want to.
So my recommendation is that they should generate a permission form to have what this screening does, and to the schools that have the ability to do it, they could be sent home to the parents and they can begin doing that.
So you want the commission to generate a form and not the school to generate a form?
Or they should at least give the information that it's going to be on. I don't know the extent of what this screening is that they want to do, so I'm assuming they have a template of what
Brady.
It looks like.
Can you do that?
I mean, Dr. Brady must have a form that he's doing with students now.
I'm sure he has one.
Oh.
All right.
Is that
what you need?
Yes.
A couple of other information pieces real quick. As you all know, tomorrow night is, I hope you all know, tomorrow night, 6:30 at the CDC is the Act 46 Exploratory Committee meeting. On the agenda is a review of the articles of agreement that were drafted by our consultant and the document that formed Mount Anthony Union School District. So both of those are on our website, and there will be hard copies available at the meeting tomorrow night. The principal search committee for Jim Law's replacement because of his retirement, they're ready to begin their first round of interviews. We had hoped that that was going to happen this week, but not all the candidates were available, so my understanding that will take place next Tuesday. And teacher negotiations will begin finally on November 14th, and that will be a ground rule laying meeting. I know that the support staff negotiations has been ongoing, so the 14th will be ground rules, and then the 28th of November and the 12th of December are the next two scheduled meetings for that. There's a lot of work to do on that, so that's it.
Okay, thank you. Food service?
They didn't meet.
Did not meet.
They didn't meet, okay. Last SVSU, we heard the similar presentation that we had this evening, except it was geared for the whole supervisory union and not a individual.
And the other item on that is the fact that SVSU were starting to set date for preliminary budget for the next year.
The next Thursday, 10th.
November 10th.
Yeah. November 10th will be the first meeting.
Okay, and Jim gave the update on the Act 46.
I'd like to have a little brief conversation at that meeting for conversation purposes. George and I agreed that we could accept the Mount Anthony model of representation.
Known as the hybrid model.
Known as the hybrid model. Now, I've heard from a couple of board members that they weren't too happy with me, but it was to move the conversation along to see where we could go with it. Also, Ken had asked at that meeting, and as a board member on the BSD, I would like to see the figures the way you told Renee you wanted them, with all the groups added together, all school districts added together with last year's budget, and then have it broken out so that we could see if BSD would actually be paying more or the same, or possibly less, if we became all one big union.
Yeah, because all you would have to do, I would assume, is just put Bennington, put the total budget, and North Bennington, Shaftesbury, and Woodford, and Powell, and just put the MAU in the total, and then just add them up and take 65% of it, and we'll see how that compares with Bennington's budget versus the 60%.
So we did discuss that, and that proposal. So where's the 65% coming? That's one of the things that we're trying not to do, is to put out multiple scenarios and actually have it come through the Act 46 Study Committee, what scenario they want. Because I have another board that feels that it would be 85%, and they want to see what the numbers look like at 85%, and now you're saying 65%. So my discussion with the keep Renee from going completely crazy and putting out multiple scenario after scenario, I think that the Act 46 Study Committee should say, give the model that they want to see and have it put that together.
Yeah, what I'm saying, Jim, here is, what Ken's saying here is, if you add all the budgets together and you take the percentage of students we have in the district, right this minute.
Which I think is what, 63% we discussed?
If it's 63, 62, 61, whatever, and just divide it out, that would tell us, give us an idea if this is something that the BSD wants to pursue further.
Jackie, let me say this. The other night when I agreed, mm-hmm. I want you to know that I agreed to the point that I want to see the figures, so that my agreement could well change after I see what the figures are, mm-hmm. to the people that elected me to the board, which I represent Bennington School District. So I'd want to, and before I do anything, I would want to come back to the entire board and play all of this by them first before I took a final vote on anything.
I think that's the beauty of this being a study committee.
Yes.
Because anything that it does is not binding.
Yes.
It has to come back to the board, each individual board.
And I don't even think Renee has to come up with it. All she has to do is come up with the six schools, the six total budgets, and a grand total, and that's it. We can figure and look at those numbers. I think that should take you 5 minutes to do that on the laptop.
Wait, that's the information that I presented at the Act 46.
All right, we'll to keep the conversation going, we will review that. Okay.
Chair's report. I'm on the CDC, and I just want to tell you that Dr. Mungitz sent a nice letter thanking the CDC for the work they did over here in Molly Stark with the CDC. They were very appreciative.
It's very, very impressive work.
And they were also very appreciative of the comments and article that was in the banner, mm-hmm. about the boxes that the kids made over there. The kids appreciate it probably more than anybody to see that. I went to the BSBA meeting, and I brought this, whoever's interested. This is a, how do I close up an achievement gap? It's after school programs and summer school programs. And I mentioned to the instructor that was there that Bennington this year has put $186,000 into their budget for summer school and after school. And I thought that was a tremendous thing that we're doing here. So this gives you the places to contact and stuff like that. Yes? And they got an update on the principal search, and that's summer school, and that's it. Okay. Anybody have anything else?
No.
I'll make the motion. We adjourn.
I will second it.
Okay. Okay. That's just one session.
Okay. I'll make it up. So, yep.